Hello dear tea friends from around the world. Welcome to a new tea class with me, Stéphane Erler, from the Tea Masters blog and the tea-masters.com tea boutique. Today we come to the end of the technical part of our oolong fall semester classes. It's going to be exciting to see this very last and very interesting tea, the Tie Guan Yin from Anxi. And the plan for the rest of this month of December is that I'm going to revisit some of the teas that we have seen during our class, and this time instead of analyzing them like we've done, I will brew them in maybe a more festive kind of chashi, because it's now Christmas season. So after the theory, we'll go to the practice, and we'll try to enjoy really the teas that we have encountered in this fall semester, and try to make the best out of them. And I will try to demonstrate one of my takes. So, and then what I will do is I will also set up a new sampler set for the winter Tea Masters classes. I guess it will be available this week. I will then announce it formally next week. And let's start with our Tie Guan Yin from Anxi from this spring 2022. Now, first thing we can look at are the dry leaves. We will notice that they are rolled quite tightly, like Dongding Oolong. The color is a little bit lighter, so the roasting doesn't seem to be just as strong as Dongding Oolong roast. So we already have a very fruity and nature-like smells, fresh smells, and not just the roast smells on the dry leaves. Now, to brew this tea, we will use a garon, of course, like usual. And to really understand Tie Guan Yin, actually five Chinese characters are enough. They are Hongxin Wai Tao, which means red heart. This describes the bird when it's young. The color is red in the middle of the leaf when it's young, and Wai Wei means it has a crooked tail. This we cannot see in these dry leaves. We have to brew them, so we'll start to do this right away. First, preheat our gaiwan, and Tao means that it is shaped like a peach. So this is really a characteristic of the leaves of the real cultivar of Tie Guan Yin, is that they are shaped like a peach, and the tail of the leaf is crooked. So usually our tea leaf is harmonious, in this shape, but here it will be shaped like this. It is tilted to one side, and this is how you can distinguish a real Tie Guan Yin leaf from a fake Tie Guan Yin leaf. Now the way to enjoy Tie Guan Yin is by brewing it pretty strong. That's why I have almost two layers of leaves. I usually say one layer is enough, but Tie Guan Yin, its character is really its strength. So we have to go strong also. So I've used a bit more strength than maybe I would for a roasted tea, because here these leaves, they were so tightly rolled that they need strength to open up. And the second reason for doing such a brew is that Tie Guan Yin really, what is particular about this tea is the aftertaste and the strong taste. Not so much the smell, of course the smell will be delicious also, but what really stands out in this tea is how powerful it is in your palate and how it will last and make your mouth water. And you get this feeling really if you brew it quite strong. So to brew it strong, I've used more leaves than usual, and I've brewed them with a strong flow to unfold these leaves. And then we will be able also to look at the leaves that once they are opened and see if they are really this Tie Guan Yin cultivar, because lots of Tie Guan Yin, as we saw in our previous class, can be made with different kinds of cultivars, even Qingxing Oolong in Alishan, just by twitching a bit the process. But today, to learn, we need to learn from the classics, from the original teas. So this tea is really important to understand the original taste or authentic taste of Tie Guan Yin. Whoa. What a nice golden orange color. Here, have a look. Beautiful, excellent transparency. Another one. And we can now. Nice roasted smells, and because Tie Guan Yin nowadays is made like high mountain oolong. High mountain oolongs from Taiwan were so popular starting in the 80s and 90s that they had a huge influence even on Tie Guan Yin, and it made Tie Guan Yin become lighter and lighter, lose its roasting, and nowadays you get this very green type of Tie Guan Yin that have a very particular powerful scent, but which lack in sweetness in the taste, and in they become a bit more astringent also, and they don't have this long aftertaste. So here we have a Tie Guan Yin that is made with its intended traditional roasting. And indeed, it's really full body. It really goes everywhere on the palate. And it has what the Chinese call Guan Yun. Tie Guan Yin Yun, so the aftertaste of Tie Guan Yin, and it has a pleasant meaning also in Chinese, because guan is another word for powerful Mandarin with a high function. And indeed, you feel the power in this, in the taste of this tea. Delicious, I could. And let's see if we already have. Yes, a leaf has already. They have already opened up. And we can see that indeed the tail is cooked. Actually, this is the stem, so here. It also is not very flat, it has a rough texture on the surface of the leaf. Sometimes it's called the deposits on some shells in the sea, or on crab. The skin of crab is not even, so you have a bit this crab skin feeling here on these leaves, and the leaves. Okay, they still need to unfold a bit, and we. So, but the taste continues to play in the on the palate. The aftertaste is really very, very long, very powerful. But already very smooth at the same time, so no rushness. This is really the signs of a very good maker, to be able to have this balance of sweetness and power. So yeah, really I'm enjoying myself, and I hope you are enjoying yourself too with this tea. Let's soon prepare a second brew. We have another leaf here. Of course, some of the leaves, due to the bruising and the processing, will be a bit torn. Here we have an example of how parts of the leaves have been torn. We can also see the red edges due to a higher oxidation level than we saw in high mountain oolongs. So this definitely is traditionally processed Tie Guan Yin, because we can see the oxidation level is much higher than it is in the high mountains in Taiwan. Okay, let's do our second brew. Remember, in winter, if you feel it's cold inside, in order to get the most out of each brew, you may preheat your cups between teas, because they tend to cool down faster, and a cold cup that receives the tea is going to absorb a lot of heat and won't give back all its fragrances, so it really makes sense in winter to preheat your cups again. same beautiful golden color. You can see here. Find a more complete leaf. Okay, here we go. Again, what you can see is that these leaves are not evenly straight. They are crooked. They are moving one side, where the growing evenly, here they tend to turn left when I look at them from above with the stem below. So this is the original Tie Guan Yin cultivar, and the shape is quite large, not so long but large, very different from Qinxin Oolong, and therefore more or pear-shaped. For the taste and for the flavors, difficult to put really words on it. The experience of this tea should really help you to identify it and see how characteristic it is in terms of especially its powerful aftertaste and the nice balance between the aftertaste, the flavor, the scent, and the taste. So it was really a good balance between the oxidation and the roasting. We did not have too much of a fight between these two. They blend already very well together. And of course a very beautiful color. So thanks for joining me for this fall classes until now. I will finish writing up the guide I promised about these lessons to make a summary of everything we have learned in each of these classes. Probably will send it to you, to all those people who have purchased these samplers in this week. And starting next week, then we will enjoy the teas we have seen in this fall semester, not as in a class setting, but really in a chashi setting, not necessarily with a gaiwan, but probably much more with an Yixing teapot. And well, we'll see what where it takes us. Thank you very much for watching, and see you next week. Bye bye.